Well, hey, welcome to A Valid Answer with Scott and Marshall. Marshall, how you doing over there? You were out walking around today. What were you doing over in Avila, where you don't actually, you live by the coast, but you live by Avila, but tell me about what's going on a little bit over there.
Right. I went for a bike ride on the Bob Jones Trail. I keep thinking Jim Jones, but
No. You may not return to us if it's the Jim Jones Trail.
Right. So, the Bob Jones Trail, and it's in Avila, and it was just an amazing, beautiful, easy trail, easy to hike, easy to bike.
What do you see on it?
I had a really good time. It was really nice. I was worried I wasn't going to make it back in time, but I did.
What do you see on it? Like when you go there, is it mountains? Do you see the ocean? I've never been on it.
You see the ocean from Avila. But I went and it really good. You see a lot of trees. There's tons of sycamore trees in particular. There's a creek, if you will, that runs along the trail for most of the way. Then it leads out to behind a resort and some condos, and it's pretty.
Which is where we did our. I think this is where our family stays when we go to Avila, and we did our show a few weeks ago. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
a couple months ago.
There's a golf course.
Yeah, it's just
very nice. So if you live in California, if you live in Bakersfield, let's say, or anywhere in Central California, it is worth the drive. It just make a day trip out of it, and hit up the Bob Jones Trail and just walk or bike it to Avila. Enjoy the day in Avila. Maybe hit the beach and then head on back. So
if the signs say the Jim Jones Trail, go a different way.
That's right. Don't take the Jim Jones Trail at all.
Well, I'm kind of back in studio today. You notice I'm not in my house. I'm back in the studio in my office. And my son, he had his last day at work this past week. And he is going off to college this weekend. So the next time we have our show, my son will be living in Los Angeles out at college. So he had his friends come over today. And they're all at the house watching movies and playing games on Xbox and stuff like that. So I'm like, I'll take my stuff back over to the studio and do our show over here. So,
all right. So what are we talking about today, Scott? This was
Michael's trying to make a claim here. He says that our stream has doubled since he became a main part of the chat and he noticed that it's doubled. So he wants us to thank him for growing the size of our audience. So,
well, I want to thank
grain of salt on that one.
I want to thank everybody who tunes in, who
yes,
shares.
Thank you for being there. Yes. Honestly, Michael, if you're doing this, you're sharing and it is growing because of you, then awesome. I just thought it was kind of funny.
And I know Michael wants to come on the show at some point. So that's probably in the works, Michael. We just have to sort of spend some time to do a three-way.
Whoa, hold on. A three-way conversation.
And
it's not that kind of show, Marshall.
Oh, that's my other podcast.
That's your other podcast. I'm not part of that one. That's a different podcast. If you guys want to watch that podcast, you can DM. I'm just kidding. As far as I know, there is
no other podcast. But anyway,
this subject. Talking about big tech, and you know, I'm gonna go ahead and do it. I'm gonna put it in air quotes and say censorship. All right, I have both air quotes. There we go. In the shot.
Why air quotes?
Well, I don't know. I mean, yes, it is by strict definition, it is censorship. We do censorship. People do censorship all the time. Whether or not it is when we consider censorship, like we are being censored by the government or there's, you know, actionable legal censorship that needs to be, you know, fought in courts. I don't know if it's that. So that's why I put it in air quotes that yes, I believe that it is a form of censorship that's happening, but I don't know that it is something that is actionable as much as conservatives want to talk about. But basically it comes out of article. I got to find it on here, but you know, a memo that was leaked from the offices of Google within the past couple of weeks, talking about how officials and high leading positions at Google are intentionally wanting to make sure Donald Trump doesn't win the next election. So they are going to use their platform to alter the way people search things so that they can reduce the hits on Donald Trump and they want to play a part in making sure he doesn't get elected. So they're planning on using, it's a memo, a leaked memo from internal memo that, where they're planning to use their platform to affect the election, to use the power of their platform, a bully pulpit, if you will, to affect the election. And then also this quote from Tim Cook, who is, of course, the CEO of Apple. Where is it? I'm putting it over here. Tim Cook quote at one point says we, and when he's saying we, he was talking about a conglomeration, talking about Google with YouTube and Twitter and several different platforms, literally saying that they have a message to those who want to push hate. You have no place on our platforms. So it is an intent from the leaders of these big tech companies to say what we consider hate, what our companies consider to be things that we don't want on our platform, we are going to remove you from our platform. We are going to use the immense power of our platforms to affect the election and to coerce minds, basically is what they're saying. Even to the point to where certain videos of conservatives are being blocked or restricted or put it on restricted lists, which then take them off of searches and affect the analytics on how they can be found. Certain conservative voices, especially on Facebook, on YouTube and stuff, people on Twitter being banned, conservative voices on YouTube having their entire catalog of YouTube videos that they've had for, you know, months and years being demonetized because YouTube has decided that their content doesn't match with what YouTube wants to have on there. So it literally is censorship of conservative thought and a concerted effort to affect the minds and voting decisions of the public by using their powerful platforms of tech. This is from their own words. This is from their own leaked memos, internal memos, and from their own public statements. So this isn't like conspiracy theory and we think this is happening. This is from their own public statements, leaked memos from their own places, and actions that are already happening.
They could be sending this message, Scott, but there could also be a cynical take on this, which is that they're simply virtue signaling to the youth who are far more to the left than the mainstream or from compared to people 50 and older. And they could just be doing it as a marketing ploy. They're trying to build up their brand, particularly amongst the youth. And it is entirely possible. We would have to look at the data.
Well, you mean that's what I'm saying. It is happening.
Censoring much, but they're making these statements because it's politically and financially popular for them to make these statements.
Right, but then we also have a leaked memo. That wasn't public.
Yeah, that shows their intention.
Air quotes, leaked.
And you got to understand that sometimes leaks are intentional, mm-hmm. and they can be done for any number of reasons, including to misinform. Look, if these guys are willing to censor opinions online, what's to put it past them that they're willing to play to the public in order to gain some sort of advantage for themselves, some sort of popularity or whatever it may be. Mm-hmm. Obviously, there's a financial incentive that's driving what they do. They could simply be virtue signaling. I mean, look at the whole, Gay and Lesbian Month, Pride Month, as it's called. Mm-hmm. Look at all the corporations that suddenly in June, all their commercials, everything's rainbows, mm-hmm. everything's about the gay culture. And then all of a sudden, magically, on July 1st, it's over. It just disappears. Yeah. You know, these corporations aren't really interested in that movement. They're interested in selling product. And the same thing could be happening with Google. So I want to throw that out there. And I want to suggest that really the way we get to the bottom of this is we look at data. Now, I shared an article with you prior mm-hmm. to the show starting because, again, we test our topics before we come on here and discuss them. We don't just choose them off the cuff. So I'm going to put the link. It's from the Daily Beast. And according to the Daily Beast, they say that according to the metrics, the data that they've looked at, and we may or may not take this at face value, that right-wing discussion online is taking up more than half of the traffic. In other words, that there's no evidence in the data of conservative suppression. On the contrary, the right-wing thought and commentary is getting the majority of traffic. So there's that.
Yeah, I'm looking it up. Sorry, right now.
Did you see my link? Did you guys catch the link? The link is.
Did you put it up on the?
I put it in the comments. Okay, so people can look at that at their leisure. I think you've seen it, and you and I talked about this. Well. And I want to share some personal experience, some personal insight that I have that some of you may or may not know. It's in there. If it doesn't show up, I apologize.
On which one? On the Kerncast one?
I'm on A Valid Answer. You're probably on the Kerncast stream, aren't you?
I am. That's what I'm watching this
That's
on.
That's why we're getting different comment threads. Okay. Excuse me. One of the things that a lot of people, and I know that you know this, Scott, because you actually visited my old workplace down in the Bank of America building, but at one point in time, and I still work for this firm, so I don't want to give too much detail.
No, you don't have to.
But I worked in media.
Yep.
And one of the things that I witnessed firsthand was actual real life censorship. So I do want to say that censorship is real.
Mm-hmm.
It happens. And there are two different ways in which it happens. On the one hand, you have hard censorship, and then you have soft censorship. Now, hard censorship is generally when the government says, this is objectionable content, take it down.
Mm-hmm.
And at this time in 2014, there was a lot of content that was going through that had to do with the Islamic State in particular. A lot of very violent content. And the content would be sent to us for, you know, consideration for publication, or, you know, it was something that we had the option if we wanted to cover the story. Here was the raw video. Here was mm-hmm. the link to the video. And usually within 45 minutes of the content arriving, it would start to disappear. Sometimes it was gone by the time we looked into it. At other times, it would be there for a little longer. But on average, it seemed like within about 45 minutes, the content would begin to disappear from the web. And so what was happening is it's being censored at the internet service provider level and at the web search level. So you got people like Google and YouTube doing hard censorship and internet service providers doing hard censorship. Now, why would they do this? My hypothesis, and it's only a hypothesis, is that the federal government or whatever agency overseas is regulating the internet in other countries is leaning on the people who are hosting this content to take it down or to make it so that it's impossible to find. So censorship is real. I've seen it firsthand, live, and in action. The second kind of censorship, which I think is what you're talking about, is more what I call soft censorship, which is where you take a substantial news article and you bury it underneath pictures of Kim Kardashian's backside or other fluff topics. You talk mm-hmm. about sports, you talk about the weather, you talk about what Trump tweeted or what he ate for dinner or served a football team. You talk about something, anything other than the actual issue that's at hand, so that the actual story gets buried back on page 3, 4, or 5. And this isn't new. Newspapers have done this for hundreds of years, where they take the actual article of substance and they have to cover it because they have some kind of responsibility, but they bury it somewhere within the pages of the paper. And what you see above the fold is the sensational news. And again, that's soft censorship. So I do want to say, from my own personal anecdotal experience, this is not data, this is an anecdote, that I've seen censorship happen firsthand.
All right. So what it is, I apologize, it was a video. It wasn't a leaked memo. It was a video that an employee shot of a Google meeting where they're talking about their plan to prevent the next Trump situation within Google. So it's a video. It was a video that a person on an insider person appears to show Google plans to affect the outcome of the 2020 elections and, quote, prevent the next Trump situation. Mm-hmm. So it was a meeting inside of Google going over plans to prevent the next Trump situation in 2020. And an employee was recording that and tried to post that. And Google has been suppressing that video, has been taking it off the web.
Mm-hmm. So, well, it's a leak, right? It's not. It's their own internal business meeting, and so it's an unauthorized leak.
Exactly.
But you could also say it's whistleblowing, right?
Is it? I mean, here's where I am personally conflicted, because I don't like the fact that big tech seems to be actively, currently, and planning to suppress conservative thought on their platforms. But at the same time, I'm also torn because they're a private company and we can choose not to use their services if we want. And I'm torn with, you know, are they not allowed to decide what content will be on their platforms? So I don't like that my beliefs are being censored, because I mean, it is censorship. It is censorship. It is bias. It is all of those things. It literally is censorship. It is bias. It's not fair. But in the end, is it illegal? I don't know. And if it's not illegal, is it whistleblowing? That's where I'm torn. I don't like that it's happening, but I don't know that I actually have grounds to be upset with it.
Well, why? I mean, okay, shouldn't the free market carry the solution?
That's what I'm saying.
If you would argue,
exactly,
that there should be a free market competitor to Google and to YouTube and to all of these, and they should have a conservative bias or a neutral bias, right? Yeah. So where are these guys at?
Exactly. You basically have to, and there is. I mean, there's a. I don't go to it very much because, well, I just don't go to it very much. But there is one called GodTube, that's been out for, gosh, it's probably almost 10 years now that has been out, and it tries to be. I think it's a little on the nose with its name, trying to be a YouTube for Christians. There are places like that. There's social media hubs, and who knows? Maybe this is what will happen. Maybe half the country will leave these platforms, and it'll just take some time to do it. And that's why I am personally torn. I don't like that it's happening. I believe that it's unfair, but at the same time, I don't know as a conservative that I can actually complain about it, because is that not a company doing what they want to do with their company, or is this too big of a resource? Is this too big of a company? Is this too big of a resource that is used by so many people for them to make this kind of, I don't know. Am I proposing things that I would object to if it was the other way?
Okay, a couple of comments, one right after the other. First, Jeffrey says, has the market share these companies grown to place them in the realm of public utility? And I would argue that could be yes. Yeah. And public utilities like your, I think your cable companies, and in particular your power and water infrastructure, out here in California, most of it's Pacific Gas and Electric, unless you're in Southern California, like LA and South. And then Southern California Edison.
Or if you're in Southwest Bakersfield, it's SoCal Edison for gas and PG&E for electric.
Yes, there's an overlap there because we're right there on that border.
Yeah.
And then Michael says companies shouldn't be touched by politics. But the problem that we also see is that companies are also touching politics.
Yeah.
And they touch it a lot. In fact, too much so. And I have a major beef with that. But I don't want to go on that bunny trail. So the question then is, if these guys are a public utility, if they're providing a public good, like, is internet a public good? Is a web search a public good, like a library or something? And if that's the case, then it would have to be regulated by a public commission.
Mm-hmm. Are they? Is there a public commission for these things that I don't know about?
Well, I mean, maybe it already is. There's the FCC, which regulates, digital content and media in the United States. But they are sort of like a guard dog. They're making sure that, kids aren't getting online and accessing objectionable content and stuff like that. But obviously, as my own experience tells me, there is somebody out there in the shadow that is saying this is okay, this is not okay, get rid of it.
Yeah. Who says that? Who can say that?
Yeah,
who
should say that? Who controls the internet? Well, the United States controls the internet. Most of the world's internet infrastructure passes through the United States. There's only like so many nodes. We're getting into the architecture of the internet. But basically, the United States controls much of the World Wide Web, almost all of the traffic through the World Wide Web.
And Russia controls most of the dark web, right?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. But, the World Wide Web was invented here in the United States.
Mm-hmm. By Al Gore.
We pioneered it. Well, it was a series of tubes. Yes. And so there are certain benefits that go along with that. And I would imagine that certainly our government and our intelligence community has made wide, extensive use of those benefits. Other countries have tried to pioneer their own internet services, specifically to cut the United States out. But as far as who is cutting or who is calling the shots on the web in the United States, I'm not sure. We know the FCC has some sort of, you know, influence or impact. They can certainly regulate you to some degree, but beyond that, I don't know. Is it the Wild West? And if it's the Wild West, what do we do?
Yeah, that's where it comes down to. Because again, if I want to make content and put it on YouTube, if I want to be a YouTube content creator and you know, put my messages or whatever out on there, I have a fear that, and I think a fairly grounded fear that if I say the wrong thing, I could be censored. I could be my whole. I mean, this literally happened to Conservative Voice. I can't remember his first name. Crowder. It's Louder with Crowder. But his entire YouTube library was demonetized because YouTube decided that, sorry, we think your stuff is offensive and we're not going to let you make money off of it.
Yeah. Well, and that, YouTube has also been cutting back on the payouts anyway. YouTube is a subsidiary.
Like literally,
to Google.
They demonetized this person because of their content.
Right.
Demonetize the whole thing.
YouTube is subsidiary to Google now. Google
yes, they're owned by YouTube. Yeah, Google owns YouTube. Don't they own Twitter too?
I don't know who
I don't
owns
know.
Twitter.
Sorry, no, I'm thinking they're independent. It's Facebook and Instagram that are owned by each other.
So, what's
when you have all of this invested, you've put your time and everything invested into this, you know, into this digital domain that basically, I mean, honestly, you assign the agreement, you say okay, and the agreement is basically saying you say it's okay that we can say whatever we want. And that's basically what's happening. And there's really no legal way to fight that. It's just like their terms of use. Yeah.
When you post a photo on Facebook, well, Facebook gets the rights to that photo.
I mean,
there's all these terms and agreements, and we all just scroll to the bottom and click agree. And we're giving up all kinds of rights and everything. And the end result is corporate America, the corporate world, really, it's no longer corporate America. These companies are multinational. These companies really have us over a barrel just about any country you go to. But Europe in particular seems to be fighting back. They've passed some very robust privacy laws. They have the right to be forgotten across the European Union, and they have handed out incredibly steep multi-billion-dollar fines to some of these corporations who have not complied with the law. And ultimately, that's probably what it's going to have to come down to here in the United States. We, the people, built the internet through, you know, DARPA and the university system, the grants that we handed out. It runs through public utilities. It's
why are you still doing that?
Utilities.
I want to. Josh Gunderson's been letting somebody make money on a private platform is another issue. Josh, clarify that on there real quick. I'm not quite sure what that meant. That way we can discuss it in just a second. But go ahead and keep going.
So at the end of the day, I think here in the United States, we the people have a right to essentially manage or have some sort of say in what's being sent to us. And my solution is this: I'm opposed to censorship. I think that we have to get things across on the merit of the idea. And if you can't convince a person of the merit of the idea, then it's either, you know, it's your problem. It's your problem.
So real quick, just to play devil's advocate on that, you're okay with hate speech?
If a person is an adult and they want to access hate speech, who am I to say no? There could be any number of valid scholarly reasons to access hate speech. Maybe you're studying hate speech. I don't know.
Well, I mean, what if you are a content creator and you want to create hate speech and put it out? Should that be censored?
What I think it should be is it should be behind a link. So what you would do is you would say, you know, that this content is, you know, may be objectionable. And if you really want to view it, you're going to have to click this link to see it. And you're going to have to demonstrate that you are at least 18 or older. And then it's on you if you choose to view the content. You assume the liability. We don't have an absolute right to free speech in the United States. Mm-hmm. Fighting words, speech that creates, clear and present danger, imminent danger, whatever it may be, that type of speech is not protected. And if you are, let's say you're influencing people to do things like, you know, you're telling people, hey, commit suicide and people suddenly start committing suicide, or hey, commit hate crimes and people start committing hate crimes. Well, certainly, if not criminal penalties, there's certainly going to be some kind of civil liability for what you're doing. And that's really up for the courts to work that out, you know. But at the end of the day, I don't think that adults in the United States should be restricted from viewing content that they want to see, no matter how objectionable I or you may find it to be.
My question is, who gets to decide if it's objectionable? Like, you know, who gets to say, sorry, Scott, your biblical views are considered hate speech, and now we're going to put it behind this blocked door like it's porn, and you have to prove that you're 18 and it's going to be restricted.
Well,
who gets to decide that?
At what point a person can still access it by registering and demonstrating that they are an adult? I think that's a reasonable precaution to keep.
No, but I understand that. I understand what you're saying. But who gets to decide when it gets to that level?
Well, I think the public should, and the public would do so through, you know, the FCC or some other regulatory body that may be established for this purpose. It would have to be probably it would be an appointed body appointed by the president and or Congress or the Senate.
It's the internet, though. You can't do this on a per piece basis. It's just too much content.
No, no. The internet service providers would be responsible for following the rules established by the committee. And I think this is really how it works in the status quo. So I don't think what I'm proposing is necessarily revolutionary or novel. Mm-hmm. It already exists. But what it is I'm just saying that we should not be taking down content. Look, if you want to,
but here's my question.
That should be up to you.
Yeah, but here's my question. Even the FCC is not decided by the people. The FCC, everything in the FCC is appointed. Those people are appointed in there. They're not voted in. They are not elected in. You do not get to choose who is put into the seat of the FCC, who's going to make that decision.
Right. That's why you have to win the elections, because the people you elect are the ones who are making that decision. Now, I don't have any issue with democratizing that department or that committee. I would be perfectly happy with allowing a popular vote to roll forward and, well, here, you know, vote for who you want to be on the FCC or whatever this panel may be. I'm all in favor of more democracy, not less. But the way it works right now is our politicians get to pick, and those appointments are very political. Look at what's happening here in California with the PG&E. Look at how PG&E is about to pass billions in liabilities to customers for the fires that took place last year, because there's no way they're going to let their profits be touched, you know, by all of these pending court cases. I mean, PG&E is on the verge of filing for bankruptcy. They've even said that, I think last month they sent a letter out to a lot of people saying that if you have any kind of claim or anything to PG&E, now's the time to submit, because PG&E is preparing to go into bankruptcy because they want to get out from all of the liability.
Well, if they go under, I've got solar on my house, so I should be good.
Right. Well, and even then, the way...
Although I don't have a battery, it's all done through PG&E.
Right, exactly. So they have their hands even in that. And again, that's because the Public Utilities Commission in California, and I'm sure it's this way all across the United States, is simply, it's all PG&E hacks. People who PG&E said, hey, this person wants this seat, can you give it to him? Oh, sure, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm sure, you know, somebody bakes a pie, and inside the box of pie is also an envelope full of cash.
You've seen Shawshank Redemption, huh?
Yeah, great movie, fantastic movie. But this is happening constantly in our republic, and it is the reason why a republic is the way it is. It's the reason why we have all of these issues that we have.
All right, so Josh, real quick here, He clarified his question, and I want to come to that real quick. He said YouTube monetizing your content is a private transaction on their platform. If they demonetize political content and you create political content, shouldn't they exercise that control? Censorship in the private world is different than censorship in the public domain.
Right. Well,
and that's what we're talking about. And I think I agree with him. I think the question comes down to, has this crossed over to no longer being a public domain, no longer a private thing, or is it? Should it fall now into the being a public utility, which is controlled by different rules than just simply saying, you know, a private transaction?
Right.
But yes, Josh, I thank you for the clarification, and yes, I totally agree. That is my issue that I'm having with this, because like, yeah, they really should be able to exercise that control. Honestly, I don't like it, but there you are.
I want to point out that demonetizing doesn't sound to me like censorship. They're just saying you're not going to get rich. You can still make this content. You can still post it. People can still view it. It can still go viral. You can still share it.
Yes,
you're
but
just not going to make not going to make money off of it. Now, that may fall under the realm of soft censorship, in that if you are a right-wing media organization, that's how you pay your employees, and now they're taking away your income.
Yeah, they closed your business, because that's potentially you know,
Alex
thousands,
Jones.
Ten thousands, hundreds of thousands. Millions of dollars. Entire companies exist as YouTube channels that make millions of dollars a year off of YouTube advertising, and that's their whole business model is based on that. So effectively, they came in and their store got closed.
That's literally insane. That's an absurd business model, because again, all your eggs are in one basket. And if the person holding
it's the same thing. It's the same thing. A mall could simply say, "Hey, okay, well, your contract is up, and your store is not going to be open here anymore." Uh-huh. It's the same idea.
Right, but again, there's strength in diversification. So any business worth its salt should seek out immediate diversification, mm-hmm. and say, we're not just going to distribute on YouTube, we're going to find other platforms, and in fact, we may find our own streaming service. This is what Alex Jones did when he noticed that the vultures were circling.
Well, that's what Glenn Beck did, and that's when he started Blaze Network,
Glenn
whatever,
Beck did that. Yep.
However many years ago that.
Yeah, so I mean, that's just a strategic decision, and y'all got to recognize that with the handwriting on the wall, that Google is a massive, massive, very wealthy multinational corporation. Mm-hmm. They can afford to pay the steepest fines and still keep on running. There's no competitor to them. They are the 800-pound gorilla in the room, and it's like the old joke, how do you get a rug from underneath an elephant? Well, you wait for it to move. And so if they don't want to move, you're done. So you can't put your eggs into that basket. I think I've just dropped like six analogies in a row. I apologize.
Jeffrey commented, I think commenting back to Josh, saying the highway system, a private truck company can make money on it, but must follow government rules. So
And I agree with that.
So again, but that's on a public highway. Should YouTube be a public utility? Mm-hmm. Should Google be a public utility? And what does that mean if it does?
If not, there should be a public alternative created, in which case the federal government would create a public alternative, just sort of
which will cost three times as much to run and make much worse content and be a be a dismal failure because government can't really do anything right. But
again, that's kind of where we're at, you know. So either you play by Google's rules or we create our own. And, you know, what do you do?
Go ahead.
I like the highway analogy, that a private truck company can make money on it, but it has to follow government rules, like not censoring content. That's from Jeffrey Spivey. And I think that's fantastic. And that's what we have to say, is the infrastructure, the actual cables and wires and other things, this is a national good. We may have privatized these things, mm-hmm. and I don't think that's something that should be privatized. It's a national public good. Of course, the fact, if we hadn't privatized it, then who knows what condition it would be in right now. Mm-hmm. But that's another
You've seen the roads in California.
Yeah, that's a whole nother issue I have. There is no reason why government controlled should be synonymous with run down and failed and corruption, but it is in our country. And so it makes sense, of course, that it's privatized. And yes, private does give us better results here in the United States, mm-hmm. because our government has been corrupted by the private.
So ultimately, I think this comes back down to what I keep saying when every time you bring up, oh, well, Walmart is this or such and such is this. It's like, yeah, they're the big ones right now. And we can complain all we want about them. But someday it's cyclical. Somebody's going to come and put them out of business.
Yeah.
And somebody's going to come and put Google out of business. Somebody's going to come and put Amazon out of business. Somebody's going to come and put YouTube out of business. Somebody's going to come and do this. These things are not here forever. And I think that there's the possibility that if they do become a public utility, that makes them be here forever type of thing. You know what I mean? That gives them more wait if you say to stick around. So ultimately, as much as I don't like it, it's going to sound surprising. And I brought up this topic, but again, I told you offline before we were going to come to this. I'm like, I just want to discuss it because I don't know that I have a position either way, and I could probably be swayed by this conversation. And ultimately, when it comes down to it, as much as I don't like the censorship of fellow people who share my beliefs, I think I have to side on the side that this is a private company that right now may be the biggest one that's out there, maybe the one that everybody's going to. It may seem like it has the monopoly and the hold on everything like that. But if I certainly believe in the private sector, if I believe in that you can choose who you're going to spend your money with, you can choose who, and that your money votes, and basically you can create something new, and the next best thing that will come out will defeat what is currently the behemoth, then I have to believe that we just have to get through this, and somebody has to come up with another solution that people are going to like even better. And if not enough people like it, then we're just on the downside of, well, this is who we are, until this is what we can get until somebody comes with a better solution. But I have to believe that that's the way it should work. Crazy, right?
Right. Well, I personally, I'm opposed to censorship, although I understand that certain content should be behind some sort of a verification page, warn you that you're about to see something.
So you're against hard censorship, but you're okay with soft censorship.
Well, now, again, if you're allowing a person to pass through like an age verification service or something like that, and they're still able to view objectionable content such as hate speech or right wing hate sites or left wing, you know, violent Antifa sites, let's say, I'm okay with that. And to me, that's not really censorship.
Remember, Antifa's not an organization, so let's not go there.
Right, right. So it, to me, it's like you're taking a prudent precaution. It's just like checking IDs at a door at a bar. Mm-hmm. And I don't have an issue with doing that. You're not prohibiting alcohol when you check a person's ID to go into a club. You're simply ensuring that the person who's about to partake is fully cognizant and responsible for what they're about mm-hmm. to, you know, get
again,
into.
Again, you and I are in agreement on that. Mm-hmm. The issue is, because again, it's the same thing. If you want to go to an R-rated movie, you have to be a certain age.
Right.
Because exactly. All that kind of stuff. The question is, who gets to decide what it's rated? That's where I have a problem. That it seems seems to be in this particular area, the people who are deciding what something is rated have a bias against certain beliefs and are willing to use that bias to silence their opposition.
Right. And that's why I think there should be a public, you know, again, the FCC net neutrality and all of this. Mm-hmm. But I think that should be democratized. And I think the public should decide who gets to sit on that board and who makes these decisions. And I think the private corporations should be expected, if they want to operate in the United States, just like if I'm a trucking company and I want to operate an American highway, I have to follow American laws.
Yeah.
And we should require Google and YouTube and other firms to follow American laws. Now, if they don't want to follow them, that's fine. They can simply not operate, which would create a massive vacuum and someone else will fill it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, right now it's very hard to get into that. Again, you've mentioned that these companies aren't going to be around forever, and that's true, but take a look at like JCPenney's. JCPenney's is at least probably 150 years old. They're still alive and kicking, and they have a... Yeah, I know, right? It's real iffy.
Alive and kicking is—they're still alive, but they're on a bed. They're laying down on a bed. There's life support on them. There's a lung machine that's helping them breathe, and there's a little bit of brain activity going on, but they're not alive and kicking.
Yeah, but they could also turn around.
Yeah.
So we can't assume that they're certainly not dead on arrival. So things can change. And you're right. There could be another firm that could come up. There could be right-wing competitors that suddenly catch on. At the end of the day, and this is what our show is all about, mm-hmm. it's about clashing ideas and winning people over with the quality and merit of your ideas. If you have good ideas, they're going to catch on and spread. That's it, period, end of sentence. And I believe in a healthy, honest, robust, open clash of ideas in the public forum. I don't want to suppress that. So, you know, if we have to say that that public forum, that a certain part of it's going to be age restricted to 18 and above, I'm okay with that. But at the end of the day, I never want to say you can't view this even though you're an adult, because I don't want you to view it. I hate that. And I certainly don't want anybody out there trying to influence the politics in this country. Again, I want to see the politicians on stage debate in an uncensored format where the American people can decide for themselves who they want to vote for.
That is an interesting thing at this point, because I do want to kind of turn that way to that leaked video by Google execs. Do you think that's a problem? That a company this size has a biased plan to use the power of its marketing and the power of its platform to try to steer an entire presidential election?
Yeah,
is that any different other than it's an outside nationality? Is that any different than Russia coming in and trying to affect our election?
Yeah, I don't think corporations should have their hands in our politics. That's a massive problem. That's destroyed our republic. And if we're going to save
is that a different issue?
We have to end that.
Is that a different issue? Should that be actionable, even if shutting down PragerU videos or demonetizing Loud Earth Crowder or all that kind of stuff? Maybe that's one thing, but using your power to affect elections, is that a different issue that should be addressed right now?
I think it's part of the same disease, but it's a symptom of the same disease. So you can take an aspirin to cure the headache, but I would also prefer to outright cure the whole disease.
Yeah. Because that's really, you know, what troubles me is using the power of that. Basically, it is a public utility that everybody uses Google to search almost. And its plan to use its algorithms to shape what people find in their searches.
Right. And again, if it's a public utility, the public should oversee it. And that doesn't mean political appointments. Again, just like the way people run for judge or run for sheriff, people ought to run for these offices, and the American people should decide with the majority ruling.
So, I mean, what other national position do we vote for besides president and vice president?
Right. Well, again, when the
does that start making it a huge thing that we now have to vote for every single agency lead in the elections? I mean, how many things are going to be listed on that voting sheet that we all have to now listen to campaigns for? And, you know, I mean,
we have to overhaul the system. You know, people could do ranked choice voting. They can vote online. We don't have to vote for everything all on one day. We can have more than one election day out of a year. In fact, we normally have at least two. We could have three or four, whatever. There are so many different ways we could do this. Remember, when the founding fathers wrote the Constitution, they wrote it for a small portion of the population, especially white landowning males, and of course it very quickly grew to all males, but there were certain assumptions that they made. They assumed a certain degree of literacy and intelligence, a certain homogeneity of thought, if you will. So the system they came up with kind of worked for that time. And what we've done is we've changed the algorithm. We've added many different groups. We've changed the technology. So there's all this new technology in play. And I think what we kind of need to do is update it. Now, I know some people don't like the idea of updating the Constitution or anything like that. But I think the Founding Fathers
that's what they built into it.
They built that into it. So that's something we have to consider. And again, I would like to see
But that knife swings both ways.
It does slice both ways, but I would like to see more democracy in this country. Mass media works a lot better than it did, obviously, 225, 30 years ago, and so on. Ashley made a comment that I kind of want. He said, Marshall, you can have that right now. The issue you have is just getting people to visit. I don't see why you can feel entitled to piggyback another site's success in its reach. Now, Ashley made that comment a few minutes ago, and so I'm not entirely 100% sure what he was referring to there. He's welcome, please, to clarify in the comments. But what I do want to say is I don't want to say this idea is okay, this idea is out. I want those ideas to clash, and I think the cream will rise to the top. So That's kind of my take on different ideas.
Yeah, I think you and I are kind of in the same place of wanting that, but also at the same time, I'm kind of stuck in the place of saying,
as don't it sits be a right fundamentalist. Now, don't be a free market fundamentalist, because we don't have a free market in the United States. At what point yeah. You have politics all over business, and you have business all over politics. I mean, those two are married. There's a wedding that took place. They are married. There is Congress that happens every single night. They are producing children, and some of those children are very poorly behaved.
You call that Congress?
Well,
wow.
So, aptly named, isn't it? So
if that's how you describe it, then you're doing it totally wrong.
Well,
on that note,
and Jeffrey, yes, I think internet privacy should be a future topic. Personally, I believe there should be amendment to the Constitution, and I believe that if it's in the Bill of Rights and it restricts things that our government can't do to you, I think that should also cross apply to private corporations. But that's me.
All right. Well, this has been A Valid Answer with Scott and Marshall, talking about all the kind of things that happen all around the world, and things that affect you personally, things that affect you spiritually, emotionally, politically. And that's what we want to bring these types of things up, have these discussions, and sway each other's opinions sometimes, like, you know, and be intellectually honest about it, instead of just saying, well, I'm going to come at this no matter what. And
yeah,
that's what we're here for, and that's what we want to continue. So hey, thank you for joining us. Thank you everybody who participated, and get, make sure you share, put that out there so your friends see this, and we really want to become rich and famous. I mean, we really want discussion.
I'm gonna share all my money with you.
We really want people to learn how to discuss. And learn, yes, how to civilly, yes, discuss. And that's what this show is all about. So thank you for joining it. Thank you for being part of it. We'll catch you next time, Sundays at 5 o'clock, right here on A Valid Answer on Facebook, kerncast.com. Till next time.
Thank you.
See ya.